long if lots of things go wrong, but ideally short. And actually, there are quite a good number of us who are going to get up and participate in this presentation. So I want to give lots of space for that. I'm Frankie Abbott, curation and education strategist at DPLA. And I am joined by a great group of people who have all worked hard on the primary source sets project. I will let them introduce themselves as I get up to say what they're going to say. But as a general agenda for the talk, I'm going to give, with Audrey Altman, who is the lead developer on this project, a little bit of an overview of what the project is. And then you're going to hear from actual members of our education advisory committee, who were the educators who worked on the project and contributed some really valuable insight into how it should be developed. And then at the end, Audrey is again going to share a little bit of information about what we know about how much the project's been used thus far. And Samantha Gibson, who also works on the education team, is going to share a little bit about the preliminary sharing and marketing that we've done and some of our ideas for how to get the word out about the primary source sets. So I imagine that this is actually an audience that knows a lot about the DPLA relative to the education-related audience that we generally present the project to. But just for some background, the DPLA, obviously, as you've heard probably multiple times, is currently at 13 million items from 1,900 contributing institutions. And the basic mission of the DPLA, of course, is to amplify the signal of its partners' collections. So it's one place that gives users a sort of single access point to content from all over the country and a great diversity of institutions. But we also want to play an important role in getting that stuff used through DPLA to complement usage that's happening on partners' own websites. So in terms of what DPLA is currently offering an education audience, the sort of basic premise of the project is right now the DPLA primarily works with cultural heritage materials, although you've heard that that is expanding as we think about ebooks and newspapers and other kinds of things. And so the DPLA right now is making, we think, to educators pretty rich offerings in terms of US history, culture, and more. There are, of course, a goodly number of projects online that are offering particularly US history primary sources to educators. So some things that we think makes the DPLA's project unique and special because of the collaborative partner network that we collect primary sources from. The DPLA actually has a really interesting mix of national and local sources, which make for really rich education resources. So because we are able to request and use items in the primary source sets, as you'll see, that are from very small local public libraries, small historical societies, very large national museums, there can actually be a really rich mix of material for student and teacher investigation about US history and culture subjects. And of course, also a value to educators. The things in DPLA are all vetted, described, lovingly shaped by information professionals for an audience. So DPLA is a research resource, and the primary sets are research resources that have had lots of information professional and now educator hands on them, which makes them a kind of a vetted resource offered to them for free in a nonprofit, non-biased context. So when we started education work at the DPLA, we learned a lot about the value of primary sources for the classroom. Of course, these are just some basic ideas, although there's a whole rich conversation to have about what you can do with primary sources in the classroom. But of course, they're really useful for exploring context. They also are really important materials for the support of inquiry-based instruction, which is important across disciplines, important in history and social studies, as well as other things, and an emphasis in a lot of state standards and, of course, national standards as well. And finally, digital primary sources provide useful material for a variety of different kinds of projects, from digital storytelling projects to document-based questions and the kinds of digital projects students are increasingly building in the classroom, interactive timelines, exhibits, and the like. So we started the education project, I'm not going to belabor this, but with a research phase that was about 9 months long and was funded by the Whiting Foundation, and we produced a paper from that research that you can find at tinyurl.com/DPLAeducation. And to do research for that project, we did interviews with kind of two groups of people. We had focus groups with educators. At that stage, we had focus groups with sort of educators in 6-12, primarily focusing on the humanities, but also including a goodly number of school librarians who helped us think through that disciplinary focus and whether that was a good idea. And we also did a lot of interviews with more experienced education resource projects. So we talked to some folks in the broad kind of open education resources world. We talked to projects that you have seen maybe presented at the fest, like DocsTeach from the National Archives, various education initiatives that have culminated in the Smithsonian Learning Lab, the folks at the Library of Congress, as well as our own service hubs, some of whom, like CalSphere and the Portal to Texas History, had already started creating sort of state-focused education resources projects. So we wanted to learn from their experience, and of course we also wanted to get a sense of what educators saw when they came to a site like the DPLA and what they thought its unique contribution and potential might be. From that research, we derived sort of three main findings. The first was that it was important to create education resources online that could be used really by both students and teachers, so that the sort of older model of creating very teacher-focused things, lesson plans and the like, that were kind of implementation instructions, was not a path that we should pursue, creating things that were open-ended and could be found by student researchers and used by student researchers. We also learned, although it may be obvious to all of you in the audience, it was important for us to embrace, that we really wouldn't have an meaningful education project if we didn't have constant iterative engagement from a group of educators in creating it. That, in fact, having them involved in the design of the project, having them, as you'll see, do a lot of the curation work in the project, and having them give us feedback on how the project was being received and how students and teachers might actually use it was pretty much the foundational idea that became the primary source sets. And finally, from that research, we had a lot of discussions about how the idea of primary sources for the classroom could be organized in a meaningful, sort of digestible way for students and teachers to use. So the primary source set idea is not a new idea, but we like to think that we've put a little bit of a new spin on it. So we had some conversations about how those could be meaningfully collected, what the size of a topic might be, what the scope of the resources involved, and what sorts of supplemental materials might go with them. So we left the research phase thinking that we would pursue a sets project that we needed help shaping with the help of an education advisory committee, who you will hear from. This is unfortunately just a screenshot of four of them, although you can see the lovely Ella Howard sitting in the front row, making sure, as well as the lovely Carrie Dunn. But there are in fact 10 members of this committee. We had a very competitive application process for this. We got a second round of funding from the Whiting Foundation, and so we had really about 10 months to put this together. And so we put out a call, and we got more than 300 applications for folks to be on a committee of people that was actually originally supposed to be six, after which I had a total meltdown because we had so many good people who applied. And I begged and begged for a tiny amount of funding from Dan for us to add four more people to the committee. And they are just the best cross-section of folks from English and history and school libraries in middle school, in high school teaching, and in higher education. And they are really the success of the project. You'll hear more from them about their experience. But we got them together and worked the project in a few phases that I'll go over. This is a boring slide with no graphics, so I want to apologize for that, but I was running out of room, as you can see. So they all applied in June, and we had already gotten them together by July, which was a pretty speedy timeline. And so we met in person in Boston in July, and we designed a template for the sets. So we made some of those decisions about the supplemental materials that we would create that a primary source set needed to be usable by students and teachers. We also made the decision that the sets would include 10 to 15 primary sources picked from DPLA's partner content. And then we did, as you can see, three rounds of set development with the Education Advisory Committee. So we've produced 100 sets in about 8 months, which was a push and involved a lot of really hard work from them. And we've had some ongoing conversations about the total group of topics that we would cover, but generally we made efforts in a lot of different directions as time went on. We knew from the beginning that we wanted strong groups of US history sets and American literature sets. We also knew that we wanted to make some strong efforts with underrepresented groups, and we wanted to offer some, what I like to think of as like new takes on familiar subjects. So we wanted to, for example, focus on some set topics within the broader scope of the civil rights movement that were perhaps like less often taught on a regular basis in the classroom. We also wanted to take and do with cultural heritage material what you can in the sciences, which is kind of history of health, medicine, the development of technology. And of course, we wanted to give some focus to the arts. And we also wanted to run all 10 eras of the National History Standards. And so we built the project with some attention to trying to get some good distribution over time and trying to meet those goals in three iterations. So we would give some general assignments to the folks on the committee. Of the 100 sets, 55 are written by the Education Advisory Committee and 45 by the DPLA staff, but they are all reviewed by the Education Advisory Committee. And so that peer review process was, I think, really important for the development of the project. And frankly, for the staff, it was really important for us to feel like the work that we were contributing to the project was keyed in with what the educators we had enlisted to help us thought was valuable or not valuable in an actual teaching context. So we published a first group of sets in October 2015, and as Audrey will discuss in a minute, we also actually launched the sets project online that you'll see. And then since, we built out a second round that launched in January 2015, so 30 sets, 30 sets, and then just on Monday, the last group of 40 sets that we put up. And then finally, and this appears to be cut off, which is a shame because it was a riveting piece of writing on this slide, we met in March and had a sort of wrap-up meeting for this phase of the project in which we got the Education Advisory Committee back together in March, and we talked through what we thought had worked well about the project and what needed some improvement. And also they made some recommendations about where the DPLA might work on the primary source sets as well as education more broadly in the future. And then simultaneously, we did things on the development side, which Audrey's gonna talk about just for a second, to put the project up online.
Hi, everyone. Audrey, I was the tech lead on the project. And my notes are on my iPhone, so that's why I brought my phone up. I'm not texting, I promise. So our design phase was sort of fast and furious, which was, I think, characteristic of the timeline in general for this project. It was, pretty ambitious. What we did in the first part, the gathering design ideas, luckily we had a lot of ideas because Frankie had done that year-long research project where she'd been talking to educators and people in the community. So she had some pretty strong ideas right off the bat. And we also were able to meet with the EAC a couple of times and get their feedback about it. So we went through this, very hands-on iterative process of developing some requirements. We made some personas, which for those of you who aren't familiar are these sort of representative users. And you represent them as like real actual people so that you can, start to think a little bit in a more sophisticated way about like what exactly somebody's gonna do when they get to the site and what their specific needs are because they're a student or because they're a busy teacher. And then we made some mock-ups of what the web pages would look like and brought them to the Educational Advisory Committee and were like, what do you guys think of this? And then they like ripped it apart. No, they didn't. They were very nice and supportive. But they had a lot of ideas about how to improve it and how to prioritize what features were actually going to work well in the classroom and what we might need to add or take away. In general, we were trying to keep them as simple and streamlined as possible, which is, it's a design challenge because the temptation is to like add on all the things you could possibly want, but we were trying to take away. So then we entered into the building phase, and so we have the public-facing web pages that you'll see if you go to the website, and there's also an administrative backend for the administrators to go in and like enter all the data and upload all of the images and video and stuff. So a quick rundown for those of you who are interested in the technology piece. It is a Ruby on Rails application. It has a SQL database on the back end. The media files are hosted on an Amazon S3 server. We get some information from the DPLA API, and it's all open source. So if you're interested in using parts of the code or looking at the code, then you can find it on GitHub. And I'm happy to answer any questions for people who are curious about the technology, but I will not belabor it. So we launched on October 15th with sort of a minimally functional, I shouldn't say minimally functional, because it was actually pretty good. But it wasn't, it didn't have quite all the bells and whistles yet.
I'm patting you on the back.
Oh, thank you. It was, yeah. And so on October 15th, we launched, and it was in working order, and it had like all of the major functions and features. And then since then, we've been adding on some things to improve user experience. And we've started now, because especially the educational committee has been using the primary source set, so now we're starting to be in a place where we can collect feedback about people who are actually using it in the classroom, about how we can continue to make improvements in the future. And that's it.
Okay, so this is what the project looks like currently, up on online. This is its landing, or a little screenshot of its landing page. So you can see that one of the things that we've done to improve user experience, and when we put up the first group of these sets, there were 30 of them, so the idea that users would come and scroll through them wasn't really that daunting. And then as we started to add to the project, of course, we knew that the collection would grow. We didn't want people to be scrolling, which makes your head hurt, and you know. So we started implementing a tagging system that you can see here, where we started to place things in eras of the National History Standards, and also, of course, some of the categories that I was talking about before. And we've been building that out and giving users the option to filter. And also on the right, you can see sort. So people who want to come and look at these, all the sets or a subset of the sets, in chronological order, for example, they can do that up here. So again, trying to create a situation where users can surface the content that they're looking for more quickly. And also, some of the sets that are getting pushed down the scrollable page are getting a little bit more life, popping back up to the top, which Audrey can talk about, but is a strategy that seems to be working based on what we know from Google Analytics. This is a sample primary source set. This one, written actually by Amy Rudersdorf, who worked and was a wonderful colleague at the DPLA until recently. The New Woman is a curricular topic, shows up in the National History Standards as well as in lots of other places. For those who aren't familiar, it's a sort of turn of the 20th century women's movement with ideas about women and education and liberation. And so you can see here that the primary source sets have, at their base level, this page is intended to be sort of engaging for students and teachers who would want to use it. So there's an overview of the topic, as well as 10 to 15 primary sources that are newly described by the curator of the set in a caption, and then a link to a teaching guide, which is a place where a teacher could go to get some ideas about how they might actually make use of some of these sources in this set in the classroom. And if you were to click on a source, which I have done because I love this source, captioned an image of the New Woman from 1899. She reads the newspaper in her riding bloomers with her bicycle nearby as her husband does the wash. Yep, or as her husband does the wash. It's the riding bloomers probably that get me. So you can see that with help from our partners, we're allowing a pretty large access to this particular item, and then giving a little bit of a prompt now on the right side about some primary source related inquiry questions that students should be thinking about when they look at this source. We're also providing what we call citation information, because that is, of course, depending on the style guide that you use, not a fully formed citation, but is the beginning of the way that they would cite a website, as well as a courtesy statement, because we, of course, use lots of items from lots of different institutions, and then links back to records in the places where they live originally. And then finally, a teaching guide. So you can see this is, again, pretty basic. On the right-hand side, it has a generic primary source analysis tool that we developed as a committee, as well as some additional tools from some of our partner organizations, like the National Archives and the Library of Congress, for doing primary source analysis. And then some questions that call on the use of specific items in the set. So again, these are meant to be inspirational for teachers and not prescriptive. So they don't tell people how they should implement the source set, but they give some creative ideas, as well as an activity down here. As the project progressed, as you already heard me say, we worked to try to build some specialty areas, so working out from just broad ideas like U.S. history and American literature to one of my favorite little subsets of the sets, which are all about different migration and immigration histories and experiences. We also built out a sub-collection in law and government, and we additionally have sets about specific groups like African Americans and women and the experiences of Asian Americans. And then, of course, we've also organized things by time periods. Meanwhile, Audrey, behind the scenes, building some excellent connective tissue, so places where you can move between sources in a set, and also places where we are offering suggestions for related sets. So if you liked this set, you might also want to explore other things in its time period or other things with its similar subject tags to try again to circulate users within the project to some of the content we think that they might want to see. So now I'm going to turn the presentation over just for a few minutes apiece to the members of our Education Advisory Committee, who are going to talk a little bit about their experience with the project and what they think its impact might be for the students that they work with. So we'll start with Carrie. Carrie Dunn.
Okay, so I'm Carrie Dunn. I'm the Director of History and Social Studies with the Boston Public Schools. So nice to meet you all, and please come talk to me after if you have any individual questions. But I was very excited to be part of this project. I think it's filling an important niche in history and social studies education in the country, actually. So we've been pushing more and more of our teachers to use primary sources at all levels, elementary, middle, and high school, throughout the curriculum. And to encourage students to do more thought and analysis on their own and be kind of the heavy lifters in our social studies classrooms. This particular project filled a niche within that niche. So one of the educational entities out there that's been very helpful to teachers over the years in integrating in primary source analysis is the National Endowment for the Humanities. Specifically, they have a site called EdCitement. And it's a wonderful tool, and it's very helpful, especially for beginning teachers, because it has built out lessons for teaching about a variety of historical topics that integrate primary sources into them. But when you move up in kind of the moderate to highly experienced range of the teaching spectrum, often you actually don't want built out, completed, prescribed lesson plans. What you want is the raw materials and to build the lesson plan yourself. So these sets serve as a really nice complement to some of the packaged lesson plans that exist out there. So our teachers have been really enthusiastic about using them. They can take them in many different directions. And then another big difference is that, particularly with older students, you can actually have the students themselves access the sets and interact directly with them without it being filtered through the lens of a teacher in between. So it's been a great resource. It's one that I hope will expand. I think I have deep appreciation for the DPLA for even thinking about, hey, let's make this stuff that we're doing accessible to teachers and kids. And I'd encourage any digital archiving institution to really think about that as well, because that is the direction our K-12 schools are moving in, and you've got resources that would be very, very helpful to teachers at the tips of your fingers, but they might just not even know about them. So I did five sets, one on the exploration of the Americas, one on busing and desegregation in Boston, one on creating the U.S. Constitution, kind of a pet project set on 20th century mining in the Mojave Desert of California and Nevada. And the final set was on the American abolitionist movement. I had a lot of fun helping to create these sets. It was really a chance to be deeply involved in history in a way that sometimes, unfortunately, my job takes me away from. So I loved it, and I really enjoyed it, and enjoyed getting to work with educators and the DPLA team. So thank you.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Gary. Yeah. All right, good afternoon. My name is Jamie Lathan, and I'm a history teacher in Durham, North Carolina, at the North Carolina School of Science and Math. I'm very, very grateful for the DPLA for including me on this project. And I want to talk just briefly about how this project benefited my students, and then lastly, how it benefited me as a professional, as a teacher. Let me see if I can think of the primary source sets that I created first. Frankie asked that question. So my first primary source set was, I co-created it with another member of the EAC. It was on women in World War II, women on the home front in World War II. And my second set was kind of a personal favorite of mine. It was on Negro League baseball. And I recently went back to that set because Ken Burns just came out with a a documentary on Jackie Robinson, and one of my documents that was in the DPLA was a letter that Jackie Robinson wrote to President Dwight Eisenhower, kind of really demanding that he do more for African-American civil rights. So it's very, very cool. I currently teach an African-American studies course. Well, I taught it in the fall, and I'll teach it again next fall, and we'll teach another a cool ethics, leadership, and race course in the spring next year. So I'm excited about using some of these primary sources in my courses next year. I say that because I haven't actually had a chance to use any of these resources yet in my class to my students. Part of my job takes me away from teaching, like Carrie, although I am in the building during the spring semester. I mostly do administrative work. So we got Negro League Baseball. I also did African Americans in World War I, African American soldiers' involvement in World War I, which I really enjoyed doing. I did a set on Manifest Destiny, also did a set on the populist movement, and I did a set on, yes, Fannie Lou Hamer and the Civil Rights Movement. Yes, yes. So, I did a lot of said about African Americans, which, you know, that's fine. That's personal interest. And that's I'll get to that when I talk about how being a part of this EAC really was so beneficial to me. But benefit to my students. So one, I think as Carrie was mentioning, the emphasis on students being able to critically think about documents, contextualize primary source documents. Unfortunately, when students come to me, they haven't had much experience doing that. And so they are, so through these primary source documents, which I use in my class, I haven't used these specifically, I think my students are gonna get an opportunity to do history by analyzing primary sources for the first time. My students will get a chance to learn and apply some historical thinking skills, which is more of an emphasis now, especially with AP US history, and should be an emphasis in all social studies and history classes. Thirdly, I think this project will help me to democratize history, and we've talked about that a little with the DPLA, that I can include more primary sources about different groups of people that have traditionally been marginalized in the historical narrative. So my history for my students will be more inclusive and multicultural. It's not necessarily tied to a textbook narrative that may or may not include those stories. Secondly, it's democratizing because my students now have easy access to these primary sources that were once hidden. Maybe they weren't hidden, they were just hard to find in the National Archives. So this is having them there. And I will, like Carrie said, will send my students there to explore themselves. So it's easy to find, easily accessible. Thirdly, it's a hook. You know, when I have my students look at primary source documents, it hooks them into the topic of the day, engaging students in inquiry and analysis pretty immediately. And then finally, kind of separates my students from thinking about the right answer in history and to kind of thinking more about the right question or the good questions to ask. So that's always a challenge, kind of unlearning the students from just passively taking in what the teacher says or what the textbook says and directly engaging in inquiry. Now, how did this project benefit me? All right. So I think working with Frankie and Audrey and Samantha and everybody, Dan, everybody at DPLA, I mean, it was an amazing experience for me. I've been teaching for 15 years and probably attended over 30 or so professional development sessions, and this one by far is one of the best that I've ever attended. Why? Because number one, from start, we were treated like, as teachers, we were treated like professionals, and I really appreciate that. We were a part of the design, implementation, every single stage, they sought our opinion. And so being treated as a professional is something I think maybe other professions may take for granted, but teachers, I love that. Thank you. It was one of the best PDs. It also allowed me to kind of explore my own interests. I could become a student again. Carrie mentioned that, and I know Carrie loves mining and whaling and other things. Yes, and so, yes. But I was able to explore my own personal interests, which was awesome. The ownership over the template and over some of the topics was great. And then I'm a firm believer in that you create a quality product to share, right? And so this is a product that will be shared to as many people as possible. So I love that about it. And lastly, reviewing the sets that were created by my distinguished colleagues was very informative. I think of it as iron sharpening iron, right? That we were what Carrie and what Ella and others brought to the table definitely helped me and sharpen me as a teacher. So it was an amazing experience, and I'm very grateful. So thank you.
Thank you. That's a hard act to follow. So I'm Ella Howard, and I teach history at the college level. And those document sets that I wrote, well, I could try to remember them. I worked on conservatism in the 1980s, environmentalism during the progressive era, immigration from Europe, the New Deal, and I think motivations of the colonizers. I think those were the five that I did on my own. And I wanted to start out by echoing some of the earlier comments, thanking Frankie and all the folks at the DPLA for really taking educators seriously in this project. We were involved from the very beginning in a really core way to the project, and I think that that has shaped the outcomes of the sets in ways that only teachers really understand, I think, the way that these will be deployed in the classroom. So that was central to our success. But when I saw this slide, I realized I represent the field of higher education, and that may never happen again. So I hope you won't mind if I reflect for a few moments from the perspective of college teaching in particular, because one of the conversations we've had on the committee is, how does there a continuous process of development for students in this K through 14 model? Even that terminology is sometimes controversial among college professors who reject being grouped in with social studies teachers. But I think actually these types of projects reflect not just similar content that we're working with at the high school level and at the college level, but also the fact that the context in which we're working in higher education makes these projects actually quite valuable right now. And they respond and reflect some of the current pressures that we're facing in colleges. So a couple of examples that I was thinking about. First of all, with the dialogue around the rising costs of college tuition, many universities are pressuring faculty not to assign textbooks that cost anything at all. So there's a big push for us to use open access materials. And I think the DPLA and other free sets help to fulfill that model. Even in a bigger picture, right, you can also reduce that barrier between students who might not have the resources to purchase textbooks, especially early on in the semester when they're waiting for those financial aid checks, and that increases the likelihood that they will actually complete the assignments, quite frankly. Also, we have seen in recent years the rise of undergraduate research as an industry, really in and of itself, right? There's the Council on Undergraduate Research, which is a pretty influential organization, and I think the DPLA and others could partner with that council usefully. So the push here is anything that's not textbook oriented. It's a very, very broadly defined notion of research. Anything that gets students thinking independently. But also, I think information literacy, right, not to sort of invoke all of these buzzwords from higher ed, but information literacy is really driving the first year experience at many universities. And if anyone here has attended the national conference on the first year experience, many librarians attend that as well and really focus on ways that we can use source sets in the classroom with librarians and faculty and students together. So I think that's a place where we can see these connections. Also, skills-based instruction. This is a big push in the history field. So any historians here, you may have followed the AHA's tuning project. We're all being pushed away from content-based instruction, more towards skills-based instruction. Things that you can do with students that are supposed to be transferable and marketable in the real world in quotes, right, of the job market. And I think these types of sets could be marketed in a similar way, right? So these things that we often think, well, this is pretty straightforward, this is the same thing high school students are doing, are actually really advantageous right now. We are also pressured to teach more online courses, and that's where I think these are also incredibly valuable. They can be plugged into an online class with a simple link, and you can have students visit one of the sets or multiple sets, read through the sources, watch the video clips, all of it's accessible from a distance, and then discuss these in the discussion forums on a class. And that can be done by anyone very easily in course design. So those are my thoughts just about some of the places where I think we can slot this into the dialogue around higher education. My colleagues that I've promoted this work to have been really excited about using these also in the face-to-face classes that they teach, especially the English department. They were strangely more interested than my historian colleagues. They were very excited. Some of them are already incorporating these into their classes for next semester. So this has been a really wonderful experience for me. I've enjoyed working with everyone on the team. So thank you.
This morning over breakfast checked our Google Analytics statistics so I could bring you the latest in our numbers. We've been tracking the use of the primary source sets on Google Analytics since we launched, so that's about a 6-month time period now. And in that time, I'm just going to give you a few stats. We've had over 25,000 users and over 23,000 users who were first-time users to the DPLA, which is important for us because it shows that we're engaging an entirely new audience by doing this educational project. 126,000 page views. So we're extremely pleased with those numbers. Those are, you know, exceeding our hopes about what this project could do, especially in the first 6-month time period. We've got about 92% are US users, so we have some international use, mostly in English-speaking countries like Great Britain and Australia, which is to be expected. We have the entire US covered, so the whole map is full of people using the sets, so that's good. What else have we got? So when we launch new content, we see giant spikes in traffic. Which is fun and exciting, which means that people are, I think, really excited to see how the project continues to progress. We've got the session duration time. For those of you who do statistics, this might mean more to you, is about 5 minutes that people spend on the website, which is about twice as high as average for our website as a whole. It sounds like a low number, but because of the way they've calculated and average it, 5 minutes is actually a really high number. So we're pleased with that. It means that people who come to the primary source sets stay, look around, and really engage with the materials. Frankie asked me to find out how much of the use was coming from educational institutions. And I was like, great, thanks, Frankie. I'll try to figure that one out for you. But actually, Frankie came up with the solution, too. We looked at the name of the internet service provider, and in some cases, they say things like Townsville Public Schools. So of the ones that, you know, we could... So I basically did, like, a keyword search in, you know, words like school, museum, et cetera, college, and we could identify about a third of them for sure coming from what look like educational institutions, which means that these are being used in the classrooms, in cultural heritage institutions. So that's exciting. And I think that that's all of the stats that I wrote down, but I know, referrals, right. So Google Analytics can tell where most traffic is coming from, not all traffic. So I can say that at least 41% of our traffic comes from what's called known as organic search. So it's from like a Google search or a Yahoo search, which is good because we actually came up with a whole strategy around search engine optimization, which appears to be working. We also have at least 8% from referrals, meaning links from other websites, which is good because it means that other people are finding it and linking out to it, and at least 8% coming from social media, which is good because we've been doing a lot of social media pushes around our stuff. So that's how people are finding the material and coming to it.
So, thanks.
All right, hi everyone. My name is Samantha Gibson. I work on, have worked on the education project as well as some of the social media outreach. So I just wanted to share a few ideas about where we see the sets going next and some of the next steps for sharing them. So we are very much committed to making these sets as accessible and findable and usable as possible for as broad an array of educators as possible. So we really sort of define that writ large, from classroom teachers to faculty, to school and university librarians, to students themselves. So one of the ways that we have done this or approached this, and Frankie has really led the charge here, is making the sets discoverable through other channels in addition to just the DPLA site. So they are currently discoverable through the Learning Registry's Open Node Initiative, which is a project of the Department of Education that makes open education resources available to state aggregators, which is then available to school districts. The sets are also available through PBS Learning Media, as well as the forthcoming Amazon Inspire, which is a new project that they'll be launching soon, again, sharing open education resources. And basically through all of these channels, they will refer users back to the DPLA site. So we're essentially linking back to our primary source sets. So far, the initial 60 sets are all have been sent to these channels already, and we'll be working in the next few weeks even to add the remaining 40 that just launched on Monday, so that whole set of 100 sets will be available through those channels. We have also been discussing with a lot of input from the EAC members the best ways that we can kind of get involved in the on the ground research and talking to teachers and working with them hands on to introduce not just the primary source sets, but DPLA at large. We know there's a lot of exciting work to do there. So we have and will continue to look for educator conferences to present at and to share the primary source sets. We are using our social media channels, again, to push out this content, to make sure it's in sync with the school calendar, that we're connecting to other educational channels online. And we are also exploring the possibilities of hosting things like professional development workshops or teacher trainings, so that we can work with a group of teachers very directly. The shape and what that will exactly look like will depend on future funding cycles for the project, but it's something that we're pursuing and we're really interested in. And I guess the last point that we wanted to make was that we're really interested in really cultivating a feedback loop for these resources. As you've heard, all 100 sets have launched in the space of one school year. So we are really excited, especially as we head into the next school year, to see and understand and learn how teachers and students are actually interacting with this content, if there are challenges, what they are, and how we can address them. Again, this could be developed into a more formal research process, and that's something that, again, that we want to pursue, and we want to explore what funding might be available to support that. So with that, I will turn it back over to Frankie.
Actually, we've neatly talked for 44 minutes, and so we have now the traditional, 1 minute for people to ask some questions, but maybe, again, people should do what they want, but I would love to take some questions from you guys about the project, particularly for DAC folks. Who are a rare treat to get in a room at the DPLAfest. We want to take advantage of that. I'm always available. Yes.
Do you know of any other repositories that have adjusted the information through the Learning Registry and are displaying it on their end?
So we actually had two passes with the Learning Registry. We put things in the original Learning Registry, and then we put them a second time in the Open Node. And in the original Learning Registry, I know that they were picked up by Illinois' Open Education Resources site. So the Learning Registry, for people who don't know, is a little bit, I think of it as being like the DPLA, if the DPLA was only an API. So the Learning Registry itself doesn't have a portal that you can't go to the Learning Registry's website and search for our primary source sets. They are a pathway to send resources to other places. And so through the Open Node, though, Brian Osland, who I was on a panel with, who works for the group that hosts, said that the Open Node stuff had been picked up by similar consortiums in about 20 states. But you should now be able to find our stuff on that Illinois Open Education Resources site, as well as California's My Digital Chalkboard. Those are at least two that I know of, if you want to see what that kind of stuff looks like. Yes.
5 minutes spending on the site does not sound like a lot of time. And I'm wondering, did they download and then spend a lot more time actually not being on the site? 5 minutes sounds like you really would just go to superficial, you know, not deep learning if you only spend 5 minutes.
Do you want to take that question?
So the 5 minutes number is actually really deceptive because of the way they calculate it. The first thing to know is that the last page that you visit always comes back with a time of zero. And so it like brings down the average a lot. So when you say 5 minutes, it's probably people spending more than 5 minutes, but because Google doesn't track that statistic very well, it's sort of misrepresented. You also have to, I mean, you take into account all the people who like come and look at it for like 20 seconds and say, or like 2 seconds, and are like, oh, I don't like this, and leave. Which is, you know, for any website, a lot of the traffic, it's usually between like 40 to 60% of people who do that. So yeah, probably 5 minutes isn't like a huge amount of time, but I think that once you take away all of that, those people who are sort of coming and leaving immediately, what it leaves is people who are more engaged. So, I don't know, does that help?
Yeah, I'm just wondering if you have analytics for how many people spend, let's say, 30 minutes.
Yes, I mean, I have them, meaning that I could look them up, but I don't have them to tell to you right now. But I would be happy if you were really curious. I could look them up in like 2 minutes and tell them to you, maybe after the panel.
So I'm going to pass the what it feels like to sift through the DPLA question to the members of the EAC, although I have done it myself. But I'm going to answer the enhancement of metadata question. So you'll see, I think I pointed this out when we looked, but like this, we do all kinds of, this isn't a good example, but we sometimes use a description field down here that might add additional information about this particular item. And we do like individually caption all of these things. So we don't take titles out of metadata. We write captions that include the kind of context that we think would make this seem useful in the context of a new woman set to a student. And so we actually do a lot of rewriting of metadata for inclusion in this project, which is probably what is particularly important about including links to the original if people want to make a connection between the way the item is originally described and the way it appears in the project. It seems to me like probably there are some items in the DPLA, a goodly number, that are so generically described that it would really be hard to produce this historical context information. But then there are others, frankly, that are like, you know, from a George Washington collection, and the title is like, I used this example in yesterday in a workshop, but like Man on Horse, and then it's clearly George Washington, and you know what I mean? And it's, so the question's more just that somebody did metadata in a batch, for example, right? Or they did it within the context of a particular project, and they assumed that the item would travel with the project's contextual information, but it didn't. And so we do some of that as well, where we do, all of us do, a little bit of recon about what we feel we can safely say about the item, and then we try to work that information back into the caption and the description. No, we don't. First of all, because we are really only enhancing the title, and it's really the title in a format that they probably wouldn't want to use because it's pretty lengthy. Although they have access to this, and they are aware of which items make it into the primary source sets, and they give us permissions and stuff. So we're not really doing like a whole metadata remediation cycle. We are just like picking out titles and descriptions and doing what we feel we need to do for the project with that. But there's an interesting conversation to be had about metadata remediation in the DPLA. Does one of you want to, or several of you want to talk about this, the sifting?
I mean, I can just say real briefly, and then other people can chime in. I mean, you really need to know something about the set to search it well and not have to look at 10,000 items and maybe be looking at 1,000 to find the perfect 10 to 15. So, and often they are not labeled well in the home institution. You end up seeing a lot of items that are not of use to teachers or students potentially, but then you do find the treasures that way too. But just an example, so my mining site, I definitely hit kind of the gold mine items by knowing.
Nice, nice.
or perhaps the borax mine.
Yeah.
by knowing to search for like Trona, California, Tonopah, Nevada, borax, silver mining, things that you would have to know enough to look for those items to find the treasures that you want to bring forward and make accessible and weave into a set that can tell a story of a theme.
Sure.
Sorry, I have a different question if you
want to. No, I think. That's a good question. So we gave a lot of thought about that question to this page. So we do, as part of the review process, vet the overviews as text written for students. So you'll notice that they don't have a lot of language about implementation or teachers will use this with students to do X. We also, this is true of lots of things on the internet and not just things for education, but I mean, we think hard about the value of these captions because, to be honest, the thumbnail is cute. It's giving you a little bit of a sense, maybe, of the type of thing that this is. But really, it's the caption that's going to make people engage with a particular source or not, which is why, in the context of this project, it's so particularly important for any information we have about date to show up in here. So again, I know different institutions have different feelings about dates and titles. But for this project, that kind of stuff is pretty important, as well as we try to split the difference between identifying kind of what something is in a caption, as well as thinking through giving enough context without cheating the later opportunity for interesting questions, right? So we try to strike the balance between enough context and not all the answers to the possible inquiries that somebody could make from a research perspective. And then Samantha actually has reinvigorated us all about including useful descriptive information. So sometimes the items could just use a little, what I think of as like a little historical context boost, like this is a photograph or a portrait of a person in a particular year. Let's add a couple sentences reminding students what's happening in that particular year in this person's career, and that makes this item more rich. And that's not information you're almost ever getting, maybe occasionally from some of the like National Museum of American History items. They do that kind of work in the descriptions, but most of the partners aren't going into that level of detail there. So that stuff we think about, I guess, from a design perspective. Sure.
Yeah, I just wanted to say too, we also, the choice to put the teaching guide on a separate page was very deliberate. So any information that we think is really for teachers goes on that page, and things that are for students go everywhere else, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. So it's integrated, but you're...
we tried not to hide it, but we tried to make it not, you know, the whole thing. Yes? No, each one of them knows is a link to an individual item like this.
So there is no link to an exhibit that shows how those items belong to each other if they are seen as whole.
Well, that's an interesting question. They're sometimes organized in sort of a general chronology, but I mean, I think the idea is that they're freestanding primary sources about the topic. So it's not really an exhibition in that they're not required to be viewed chronologically in order to understand. It's a looser activity than that, I think, intellectually. Like, they're not a timeline of things. They're more a collection of related resources that could be related in a bunch of different patterns is kind of the idea behind them. I don't want to hold people in the room, but we are here if people have more questions. Thanks for coming.